All right. Can everyone hear me? All right. Okay. So, since all of you are here, I assume you all know the story of this decade. We have made significant advances in AI, computer vision, visual representation, and so on. And this is mostly thanks to deep neural networks, convolutional neural networks, and so on. However, if you think, most of our learning in all these paradigms is still very, very narrow in scope. So what does a state-of-the-art computer vision system look like? The first thing you do is you download millions of images from the internet. Then you label these images. Here is a dog, here is a cat, here is a mushroom, and so on. And by using these labels, you perform supervised and passive learning. Supervised, because humans provided the labels. Passive, because the computer had no choice, but whatever data was downloaded, it has to see that. It is not creating its own data points, essentially. Now compare this to how humans learn in real world. In case of humans, we are not learning from hundreds of different types of dogs or mushrooms to learn the visual representation. Instead, most of our learning happens in unsupervised or self-supervised in nature. And because our learning is self-supervised, we are not learning it with 1 million examples. We are learning with billions of images in our lives. Second, in case of humans, we are not living inside a computer. We are physical in nature. We play with objects. We take objects in our hand. We throw objects. And this, all this interaction, physical interaction with the world, is very, very critical to learn intelligence. Third, in case of humans, we are not passive machines. We are active. We decide our own data points of what to do next. Babies decide now they want to put these objects into their mouth or what objects they want to throw and so on. Fourth, humans are not learning different model for NLP, a different model for sound, a different model for vision, and so on. We all learn, we take all the data inputs that we get, and then we learn a common model across all these modalities. And finally, in case of human, we learn throughout our lives. Our learning is continuous and lifelong in nature, and we reuse the knowledge that we learn every day in our lives. But forget all these reasons. There's a big reason why this current paradigm is not good. That is, manual labeling is just not scalable. In computer vision, one of the biggest data sets is ImageNet data set, where we collected 1 million examples by labeling over 5 years. Now compare this to 600 million images uploaded daily on Facebook, for example. In case of robotics, the biggest data sets are 1,000 examples mostly. Now compare this to what a baby does every day. Thousands of interactions every day with toys. So in my research, I'm trying to look at how we can scale up learning, go from these small scale to much larger scale, and how we can scale up and empower learning by building self-supervised, curious, and interactive physical agents. Okay, this is very complicated. So the simple way would be, I want to build robots that can learn like babies. So in case of babies, learning doesn't happen in an instant. There are different stages of learning that happens. When a baby is born, for the first 3 months, it is not interacting with anything. It's lying down, and it observes everything that is happening around it. And that stage is a passive stage. Baby does not get choice of the data. It has to see whatever is happening around it. And most of the learning is visual in nature. So that's the first stage. After 3 months, baby starts interacting with the world. Now it touches objects, it starts to interact with the objects. But most of the interactions are quite random in nature. And so the second stage is when the baby starts basically discovering its hands and interactions. Then babies start to get smarter. Now they are going to do interactions of what they want to do. Like they want to throw some object, or they want to push some object, and so on. And that third stage is active exploration. Babies are curious, and they're actively exploring the world to learn more about the world. At 9 to 12 months, babies start imitating their parents and whoever else they see. And finally, babies start to become social, and they learn with other babies in the daycares and so on, or they start becoming manipulative, and they basically get the right supervision they have to get from their parents. Now, in this talk, I'm going to focus on the first three stages, and I'm going to talk about how we can build robots that can kind of mimic or imitate these first three stages, And these are loosely inspired, essentially. So in the first part of the talk, I'm going to talk about this passive self-supervision, how we can use lots and lots of data, images or videos, and learn our favorite model, like deep neural networks, from the scratch from these data. But as I said, passive is not the way to go. Passive and non-physical is not the way to go. Learning with babies looks something like this. Babies are throwing out things, poking, throwing things around, putting things in the mouth. And so we need to do something like this to do general intelligence. But the big problem is current robotics method find it really hard to scale the number of interactions that we need. So in the second part of the talk, I'll talk about how we can use robotics to get this kind of data where we push objects, poke objects, and so on. And I'm going to talk about how we can scale this up to real-world environments, essentially. And in the third part of the talk, I'll talk about exploration. Specifically, I'll talk about curiosity, like how we can build curious robots that decide themselves that this is the next thing they want to explore, or this is the next thing they want to explore, and so on. So this is how my talk is going to look like. Start from passive, go to act more physical, and then active exploration, essentially. Now, of course, there are two other points that I talked about, especially in the case of learning from humans. For example, multimodality and continuous and lifelong. And we have been doing work in that space as well. So for example, here is a robot that is trying to learn a joint model for vision, audio, and haptics. So this is a box, and there are microphones all around the box. And we are learning how these objects sound as you are interacting with these objects, essentially. We have also been doing work on lifelong learning, specifically how you can scale up learning of common sense knowledge using lifelong learning. So in 2013, we proposed a system called NEEL. NEEL stands for Never-Ending Image Learner. This is a program that ran 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for 2 continuous years. And what it did was very simple. It downloaded images from the internet every day. It then learned models from these images of cars, parking lots, roads, and so on. It then used these models to understand the images, these unlabeled images on the web. For example, here are some cars, here are some parking lots, and so on. And by understanding images at scale, it tried to learn common sense knowledge. For example, cars run on road, cars can be found in parking lot, and so on. So in the course of 2 years, NEEL learned more than 6,000 different models automatically from the web, and it learned common sense knowledge like wheel is a part of a car, eye is part of a baby, helicopters are found in airfield, zebras are found in savannas, and so on. But again, I'll not talk about that part, and I want to focus on the first three stages, which is passive learning and physical learning, essentially. So let's start with the self-supervised learning, taking the scale of learning from million images to somehow to billion or hundreds of millions of images. But before I go there, I think there's a first question that we need to ask. Do we actually need 100 million images to learn a visual representation? And so there is a first question that we need to answer before we actually even say that let's use 600 million images or 1 billion images and so on. Now, if you look at the research trends in computer vision community, you would think that we don't need that. Why? Because for the last 10 years, every year, the GPU speeds have been increasing exponentially. The model sizes have been doubling every year. Like the number of parameters in the model will increase, the models will become deeper and deeper, and so on. But if you look at the data set sizes, it has been constant. Most of the computer vision research and papers always learn on ImageNet and then use it for their task, essentially. And ImageNet is 1 million images, essentially. So we have to ask this question. Why have computer vision researchers not created a billion image data set? Why are we still stuck with ImageNet 1 million and so on? And one hypothesis is that 1 million images is just enough to learn a good visual representation. And after that, we will basically just see not enough gains by adding more and more data to our network. And in fact, some of the researchers at Facebook found that if they learn AlexNet with 100 million images, they do not get that much improvement in performance. So there is the saturation that they tend to see. But here we ask a question, that maybe it is the shallower model that is a problem here. And so in a recent work, we wanted to explore how effective is data in learning good visual representations. We created a data set of 300 million labeled images. And we wanted to see the effect of if we increase the data size, how the models change in performance, or if we increase the model size, how the performance changes, and so on. And so the first finding that we got is obvious. Like if you have bigger data set, you'll get better performance on different tasks, for example, classification, semantic segmentation, human pose estimation, and so on. The second one is more exciting to me. That is, the relationship remains log linear between the amount of data and the performance, even at the scale of 300 million images. That means you're not seeing saturation at 300 million as well. But the best one is the last finding. That is, as models get deeper and deeper, they're able to extract more and more juice out of this large-scale data. So you can see that the two models are starting to diverge as the data size is increasing, essentially. And that tells us that if we can build even bigger models, then we can use even more and more images, essentially. And so, so it seems that using more and more data is useful, and we should continue on this path if possible. But of course, there's a bigger problem in self-supervised learning. You have lots of data. You have 600 million images. But how do you learn a deep network without labels from these 600 million images? How do you get supervision? Now let's take a step back and see how do current deep networks learn. So this is what the data sets look like. You have an image, and you label that this is a beagle. And your network is a nonlinear function that learns where you learn the parameter to give this output, that this is a beagle in this image. And the hope is, by learning this semantic classifier, this will turn to disentangle materials, parts, geometry, and so on. So then we ask a question. Is there something special about this task of image classification, that this is only useful for creating this kind of disentanglement of representation? Because if we can get rid of these manual labels, that here is a beagle, here is a cat, and so on, then we can somehow scale up the learning to billions of images, if we do not have to ask humans for label every time. And so in my research, we have been looking at things called pretext tasks. These are tasks that for where ground truth is free. It's somewhere hidden in the image, the ground truth. But to solve this task, you will need semantics. So let's motivate this with how people in NLP, and hope some of you might have heard of approaches like Word2Vec, learn representations in a self-supervised manner. So let's say you want to learn the representation of a word appliance. What you will do is, you will take this word appliance and try to predict the neighborhood words around this word. And so in this case, the ground truth is the words that occur in the neighborhood of appliance. For example, store-bought, toasters, and so on. So the ground truth is free. And yet you can learn the representation of the word appliance with this task. Can we do something like this with images? Images are richer. Texts are linear. Images have two-dimensional. They have richer spatial structure. So can we do something with that? So let's say we have two patches from an image, and we are going to put a task. How are these two patches spatially configured with respect to each other? Let me make it even simpler. I'm going to put the patch A in the middle, and the patch B is one of the eight locations. Take your time and think where, which of these eight locations the patch B comes from. Hopefully, all of you can solve this task, and all of you think that this is where patch B comes from. Now, how did you solve this task? Again, hopefully, you basically recognize that this is a bus. And in the case of buses, the label comes at the top, where the bus is going, and basically the wheels come at the bottom. So you can see, in this case, the task is solve relative spatial configuration. But to solve this task, you have to use semantics. You have to understand that this is a bus. So we can use something like this to train a deep neural network which will learn semantics, yet the ground truth is going to be free. Why is ground truth free? Because you can take an image, you can pluck out two patches from these images. For example, the eye of a cat and the ear of a cat. You know the ground truth here, that the ear is on the top right corner. So it's free because you have plugged these two patches from the same image. And now you are training your neural network to predict this relative spatial layout of the patches. And hopefully, while doing this, it has to learn semantics that this is a cat. And we use something like this, and we are going to test it on the standard task of object detection. So context is basically this method, which gives 62.6% mean average precision on object detection. And ImageNet is a supervised method. So I'm trying to compete against the supervised approaches. And with supervised, you can get 70.9. With context, you can get 62.6. So while I'm not using any labels, there's still a big way to go. And what is missing currently? If you look, the relationship between cat's face and cat legs remains similar for the first two cats. But when the cat is deformed, or there's a different viewpoint, the relationship between the face and the leg changes. So this kind of an approach that I just talked about is really good for learning generalization across instances, but it is really bad in learning viewpoint and deformation invariances. What we need is some kind of a data set that can say, this is the remote, this is a remote, this is a remote, this is a remote, and this is a remote. So like different views of the remote, but we still say this is a, all of these are still a remote. How do we get such kind of data? Well, I just created a data set in front of you. Videos. If you are basically have videos, you can basically see the same object in different viewpoints and different deformations. Here is in the top one, here's a bike under different views. Or in the bottom one, you first see the dog from the back, and then you see the dog from the side. So if we can use the video data, we can basically learn viewpoint and deformation invariance. So this is the something very, very simple that we do. We track patches in the video. We take the first patch of the track, the last patch of the track, and then we learn a representation or embedding that will put the first patch and the last patch close in this embedded space, and any other third random patch as far away as possible. So contrastive loss, essentially. And with something as simple as this, you can learn a good representation for viewpoint and deformation invariance. And so here is the performance. So if you use the fully supervised ImageNet for detection, you'll get 70.9. If you use tracking for pre-training, you get 62.2. You can still see that there's a gap. So how should I try to fill this gap? Well, someone should say, the previous approach was good at instance. This approach is good at viewpoint. Combine the two. Of course, that's obvious. So we tried to combine the two, and now we are at 65. But still a long way to go. So how should we try to bridge this gap between supervised and self-supervised approaches in themselves? So one way is, let's be more creative. Let's try to find more ways to train, more pretext tasks so that we can train our networks. And that is what a lot of computer vision papers have done in recent years. But we want to go back to the basics. We want to say, why did we start moving to self-supervised? Because the labels are going to be free. So instead of just trying to be more creative, let's see again what happens if I scale up the learning of self-supervised learning. So instead of learning from 1 million examples in these previous cases, let's try to scale it up back to 100 million and see, are the self-supervised approaches scaling at 100 million or not? And that's what we try to do in this recent paper, which was presented in ICCV. We take two state-of-the-art approaches. One basically solves a jigsaw problem, takes the patches, permutes them, and asks you to solve the jigsaw problem. And the second one is takes a black and white image and asks you to color this image. And we are going to understand the scaling at different axes. What if you increase the data set size? What if you increase the model size? And what if you increase the problem complexity? Make the jigsaw problem harder and harder and harder. So what do we find? The first thing we find is, which is very interesting and nice, is that even in self-supervised approaches, the performance keeps on increasing as you keep on feeding more and more data. And remember, in this case, there's no limit. You can use all the trillion images that are there on the internet to basically keep feeding into these models, essentially, because we don't need any labels anymore. On the second axis, which is problem complexity and model, we again find that as you make your pretext task harder and harder, your representation learning improves better and better. Now, and the one interesting question is, are these two complementary in nature? And what we found out was that both these effects are complementary. So you can keep adding more and more data, you can keep making your problem harder and harder, and you'll keep seeing improvement in performance as you go along, essentially. And that brings us to this final thing, where we trained a model using 14 million images on ImageNet and using the hardest jigsaw configuration. And so now the supervised performance is 68.5. If you remember, it was 70 before, but it has dropped because now we are only doing shallow fine-tuning, so it's not that much anymore. So the supervised performance is 68.5, and the ImageNet 14 million is 67.1. This is within the range of error. Like if you train models different time, you will see a change of 1% anyhow in your performance. So this is within the range of error, essentially. And so for the first time, we can basically start to be very close to supervised approaches, in at least in the task of object detection. So where is the state of the art in self-supervised learning? For tasks like object detection, 3D scene understanding, visual navigation, self-supervised approaches do much better or equivalent to supervised approaches. But when it comes to classification or low-shot classification, supervised approaches are still much better than self-supervised approaches. All right, so that was the first part. This is the stage where baby is trying to learn from images and videos. The next stage is baby has to start interacting with the world. And so now we have to basically create a way to create data set of interactions. But what about physicality, right? I mean, how do we create such a data set? We know, and this is 2016 when we first started looking into these problems, robotics is really hard to scale. Robots break down every 1,000 interactions. Some sensor would break down, some wire would break down. How we can, and so in the previous cases, I was talking about learning from million examples. How can we build such million example data sets in robotics? So as a first step, we tried to do something very, very simple. We took a robot, which is Baxter robot, on a tabletop setting, and the robot is going to try to randomly choose a location on the table and grasp at that location. It's random. It has no idea what the objects are. So the first one, it fails. It's random, as I said. In the second one, again, it will choose another random location, try to grasp it, it will fail. The robot has a force sensor in the wrist. So as soon as it is successful, it will know it is successful, and the face will turn happy. So you can see the face turned happy here, the smile face. So in some sense, we can use this force sensor to automatically label the data. The robot knows when it was successful or when it failed in grasping. Now we did this not one time, not two times, not 1,000 times, but 50,000 times. This amounted to having the robot run 16 hours a day without any human supervision and for 700 total hours. And this was the biggest robotics data set when we presented it in 2016, like 10 times bigger than any other robotics data set. But for the first time, we have enough examples that we can now start to use these deep networks or convolutional neural networks for learning these grasping models. And so that's what we did. We took the state-of-the-art deep learning model. We basically take an image patch and try to predict whether the grasp will be successful at different angles or not. And when we did this, we found that we can really learn a model that generalizes grasping across different. So here is a performance, 66% performance of grasping on novel objects that it has never seen before. At the bottom, you see the clutter cleaning task with the robot, and this is learned with the models. The interesting thing is, we find that as you keep on adding more data, the performance of grasping keeps on increasing. So again, data is very, very useful. It's all about data, maybe. All right, so we did a grasping robot with 50,000 examples. That got us excited. If we can do grasping, maybe we can do drones. Maybe we can build a drone that can learn by itself. But how do we collect data for drones? Well, let's build a drone that will just go and randomly crash into objects. So the goal of this drone is to randomly crash into any object it sees. And this drone crashes not one times, not two times, 11,000 times. So this is all the things the drone should not do when the drone is trying to fly successfully. So these are all the negative examples of the drone flying. We build this huge data set of drone crashes, 20 different environments, 11,000 different crashes. And then we learned a model. Now, learning a model is very simple here. You take a drone crash trajectory. The first part of the trajectory is good because it's far from the crash. In the middle, we don't know. And then as you go close to the crash, you say, this is a bad trajectory. You should try to avoid this trajectory, for example. With this simple labeling, you can now learn an end-to-end model, a deep neural network, which, given an image, will tell you whether you will crash if you go straight or not, whether you will crash or not. Now you can run this model on the straight image, but also on the image on the left and image on the right. And wherever there's a least probability of crashing, you just go in that direction. And we learned this model with these 11,000 examples, and we found again, data is the biggest thing. So here is an example of drone flying inside CMU, and this is the places where drone has never flown before. These are the test examples. This is the first time this environment is there. So people who have been in CMU might well know that this is a Wien hall in CMU. There's a library there. The drone sees the glass window, decides that it's going to crash into it, so turns before it crashes into it, essentially. Here is another case. This is a narrow hallway. We even put chairs as obstacles so that the drone has a harder problem in front of it. And you can see the drone avoids these chairs. Then it sees the door there. It basically wants to avoid the door. It tries to turn. There is not enough radius, so it does crash once while turning. But again, you can see these are all the kind of things. It has crashed into chairs before, so it knows it should avoid the chair. When we collected this training data, there were students around. So sometimes the drones crashed into students. So the drone knows it should avoid humans as well. And here is an example where the drone avoided the humans because it has crashed with humans before as well. So you can actually work with dynamic obstacles as well and do navigation with these dynamic obstacles. All right. So now that we have this approach of collecting large-scale data, I want to go back to the problem. Can I learn something meaningful from this large-scale physical data? And so we basically collect large-scale physical data of grasping, pushing objects. Poking is basically taking a finger with a skin and poking it like these. And you see what the feedback is on the skin sensor. And then you try to learn a deep network, which will basically, given an image, try to predict these performance on these tasks, essentially. Interestingly, what you'll do is you'll use these deep networks to do standard image tasks, like image classification and image retrieval. And we'll see, can we learn good representations for these tasks? And what we found is that these networks can be really good on tasks like image retrieval, but they will not compete with the state-of-the-art models, for example, the ImageNet model and so on. And we also found that multiple tasks help in learning these good representations. So the next question is, why is that? Babies are learning from these environments physically. Why are our models that very far from ImageNet models currently? And I think the big problem is diversity. The word diversity in robotics manifests itself in many ways. The first problem of diversity is diversity of environments. This is what most of the robotics currently looks like in most of the research papers. On the left is robotics in a lab. Now, here is a joke that I can tell you by looking at the image, which lab is it from? This is from Berkeley. Why? Because they have used a green tablecloth. Berkeley paper always have green tablecloths. CMU paper always have white tablecloths. This is how biased the data sets are currently in robotics. And this is what robotics research mostly looks like in these scenarios. In simulation, this is what the simulation looks like. This is definitely not looks like real world. So to make bigger advances in robotics, I feel we need to move out of lab. We need to move out of simulation. We really need to take robot into homes. But now we have a much bigger problem. The current robots are not ready to move into homes. They are too expensive and too brittle. How many people will buy a $30,000 robot as a toy, essentially? Or current robotics, like, they are not useful, the current robots, for any task. Why would anyone buy these robots? So to tackle the first problem of expensiveness, we basically built a low-cost robot version in CMU. This robot costs only $4,000. This is just assembled using the best model things we can find on the market. And this basically handles the scalability. We can make hundreds of these $4,000 robots and now collect data in the scale, essentially. The second problem is a much harder problem, actually. This is a chicken and egg problem. So I argue that you cannot have good robots until you have large-scale data of homes. But you cannot put robot into homes until you have good robots. So now you can see, we have to break this chicken and egg problem. I need to put into homes to get good robots, but I cannot put into homes until I have good robots. So to break this chicken and egg problem, what we did was we started renting homes in Pittsburgh with Airbnb. So this is very, very simple. Go to Airbnb. Pittsburgh is very cheap for Airbnb, $75 a night. You can find the Airbnb home in Pittsburgh. Rent a home, take your robot there, robot army there, and start collecting data inside that Airbnb home, essentially. With every home, you will get a different environment and much more realistic, diverse data that you need. And that's what we did. We collected data from 15 different homes for grasping, and you can see it's different floors and different environments. We took some objects of our own. We borrowed some objects from Airbnb, and so we are also diversifying on the objects themselves. And then we learned a deep learning model for grasping. The key here is, because we compromised on the cost of a robot, our robots are not perfect. They have too much noise in the control. So to tackle this noise, we also have a noise modeling network that basically learns the structure inside the robot, essentially, the noise in the robot itself, essentially. And then when we got the results, I think that was the most gratifying or most interesting part of these results. So generally what happens is if you train a robot in home, it will work good in home, but it will not work good in lab. Or if you train a robot in lab, it will work good on lab, but it will not work on home. So as long as training and test data are similar-ish, that's how it will behave. But for the first time in this scenario, a robot trained on home data not only worked better on the home data or home test examples, but also on the lab examples. So this, for the first time, tells you that there's some kind of generalization that is happening that you cannot get in the case of lab examples. But my favorite generalization is the generalization across hardware. A model trained on a low-cost robot tends to work really good even on a Baxter robot. And this is something which is unprecedented in robotics. Like, not many people will train on one and test on a completely different robot. And that tells me, again, diversification or diversity of data and realistic data is what we need. The second diversity problem, so the first is environments, or diversity of environments. The second one is diversity of tasks. Most of the robotic data sets are either too small or very constrained. They'll be only of one task itself. What we need is something like an ImageNet of robotics, right? A data set with multiple tasks. So what we tried to do is we tried to collect this large-scale demonstration data set. We asked students in CMU to first do the activity themselves, like opening bottle, wiping, picking up with two hands, typing on a keyboard, and so on. And then we asked the students to make the robots do the same thing. So you have kinesthetic trajectories, essentially. And we collected one of the largest kinesthetic trajectory data sets, which is 10,000 examples of these 20 different tasks. And for each task, they are different objects themselves, essentially. And this data set, which is called the MIME data set, is publicly available. We have been using it for imitation learning and so on. But I welcome you all to basically explore this data set. The third diversity is the diversity of hardware. Now, interestingly, this diversity exists in robotics. Every lab has a different robot, but everyone in robotics thinks that this diversity is a curse. Yeah, right? Because now Abhinav trained on Baxter. How will I test it on UR5, for example? And what I'm going to argue is this diversity can also be critical, that diversity across hardware. So what we need to do is embrace this diversity. We need to basically learn policies that are going to work, the same policy function that is going to work across different hardwares, essentially. And so we are basically redesigning the way to think about policies. Instead of just defining policies which will act on the current state of the world, it also acts on what your hardware is. So a robot decides an action based on what is around it and what its own capabilities are. And based on that, we have been basically training a policy function on thousands of robots at training, and then we will test it on a completely different robot that it has never seen before. And it turns out that this kind of generalizes as well if you do it at a large scale, essentially. So for example, for peg insertion, you can test it on a completely different robot that you've never seen before by training it on different robots, essentially. OK, so this is the second part. So I started with visual learning. Then I started to move towards large-scale robotics, large-scale robot learning. But currently, most of my robotic experiment, I always say, it starts with random. Like, randomly choose a location and grasp it. Randomly decide an object and crash into it for a drone, essentially. But random is not good, right? I mean, to do something interesting, what is the probability that you'll hit it in a random? Not much. Now, in reinforcement learning, people have been trying exploration, but always in context of a task or reward. That if you want to solve the peg insertion task, how should you explore the world, essentially? But in the case of baby, it's not trying to solve one task. It's just trying to be more intelligent, more try to learn more about the world, more better predictive model of the world, essentially. So how do you do exploration when there's no task, essentially? Now, there has been a lot of work in exploration. And see, specifically, there's a recent work on curiosity models which basically try to do exploration without any context of a task. But the big problem with all these approaches is they are highly sample inefficient. They need millions of examples before they can learn anything meaningful. Now, what does that mean? That means you can test it on Atari, Mario, whatever you like. Whatever video game you like, you can test it. But our world is not a video game. Our world needs robots to basically create this exploration. But millions of examples on these real robots will not really scale up. So we really need some approach that can scale up when we are talking about curiosity models, essentially. But there's another bigger problem with these current curiosity models. That is, they tend to get stuck in the stochastic environment. So on the top is a curiosity exploration in a maze. But if you put a TV in the maze, this gets stuck at the TV because it cannot predict the TV, like the future of the TV. And so it's basically like, oh, this is interesting. Let me just get stuck here. And in the real case, even a baby starts to get bored out of the TV and moves on to explore different things. So that's what something like should happen. It should not get stuck at a TV, for example. So how should we build a system that is better curious, like more efficient in curiosity, essentially? So let's look at why it is inefficient, why these current models are inefficient. So the current models take an input image and decide this is a policy which is exploration policy. It decides what action to take, and then you see the next image, essentially. And the way you basically train your policy is using these prediction models that, given the current image and the action, will predict the next image, essentially. And now you have a predictive model of the world, like what's going to happen next. You compare it with what actually happened in the world. And if you cannot predict properly, you reward your policy. Because this is the kind of reward, like, you should explore the world where you cannot predict. That is a basic core idea that you need. However, to optimize something like this, if you have, like, doing policy gradients, because you cannot compute the gradients across the real world, it's a black box function. It's highly inefficient, and that is why you have to use something called a reinforce operator. And that makes it really, really hard and sample inefficient, essentially. This is the problem in the current curiosity formulations, essentially. So instead of using this model, what we do is we learn hundreds of models of our world. And instead of using whether we are predicting right or not, we just use the agreement or disagreement between our models. If these different models of the world are not agreeing with what the future should be, that means you do not know about the future in this part of the world, essentially. And so this is what you use as a reward, the variance in these different predictions to train your exploration network. Now, because we are doing this disagreement, it is not dependent on the environment anymore. And so therefore, this is going to be efficient. And it's more like a supervised learning that you are doing rather than reinforcement learning anymore. You can use the structure, essentially. OK, so now that we have this formulation, we can basically test it on this TV's case. And you can see on the TV case, our thing does not get stuck. Because it realizes that it's impossible to predict a TV, let me move on, essentially. But you can now do robotics and curiosity together. So here is how the random exploration looks like with robots. But you can use your curiosity model. And here's a curiosity model that we have learned. So with 1,200 examples, our robot is already starting to do something interesting. Like it's starting to push objects, it's starting to grasp objects, and so on. And this has started to learn from scratch, from pixels. So with just 1,200 examples, it's already starting to do something meaningful. And that's what we want to show, that these curiosity models do seem that it can scale up, essentially, better. OK, however, it will be still very almost impossible to discover very complicated behavior. Something like doing with two hands is impossible to discover just by prediction errors, essentially. So what you can also do, so for example, tasks like these, where one hand holds the bottle and other hand's open, or one hand holds the, or two hands have to put act together to lift a bar and so on. You have to learn the synergistic behavior, like multi-agent behavior. Like, and they have to act together in a very nice manner. Only then you will see success in these cases. And so our idea here is to promote synergistic behavior by having this core thing that if the two agents can do something that a single agent cannot do, then you should promote these kind of behaviors as well. And so here are the kind of behaviors that you can learn with these curiosity modules. Which are basically trying to learn synergistic behavior with two robots. And you can see it's already starting to do something interesting. But you can also transfer them into real world. And so here is an example of two sawyers trying to act synergistically and trying to do opening of bottles or lifting of ball. Now, ball is like a curved surface, so you really need to hold. So it holds from one location, and then it tries to pick from the other location so that it will not roll over, essentially. Here's a case of opening a bottle and so on. And again, we are trying to discover these by these synergistic actions, not try to feed them themselves. And here's a case of lifting like a longer object and so on. All right, we have been also exploring exploration in navigation. So how, if you are in a new space, how should you go about exploring this space so that you can basically build a map of this world faster with as less examples as possible? And again, in this case, we want to maximize our coverage while we are doing exploration itself. And this is done with the locobot, the cheap robot that I was showing, essentially. OK, so here's a summary. I talked about how we can build self-supervised curious robots and the different stages, like passive learning, physical learning, and then exploration. Now, the last couple of minutes, I also want to talk about democratization of robotics. Now, one of the biggest reasons why we have made success in computer vision, NLP, is because of frameworks like PyTorch, TensorFlow, and so on. Everyone can go tomorrow and download the best model and then start competing with the rest of the world. But in robotics, there's a big entry barrier. Not everyone wants to do hardware. It's very hard to understand ROS and so on. So one of the things that we have been working on is this something called PyRobot This is an open source robotics platform. This is like a robot, which is the next version of the cheap robot. You can buy it for $5,000, or you can assemble it for $4,000. There are vendors selling this robot as well, the second version. But the most interesting thing is, we have a very nice library, high-level library, for things like manipulation, navigation, demonstration, and so on. So you can collect demonstration data by connecting it to Mechanical Turk, and so on and so forth. And so our hope is that with only 10 lines of code, you can now start doing manipulation, which is something which is very, very hard in robotics. And so this PyRobot platform is very beginner-friendly, open source. It's hardware agnostic. That means the same code will run on a UR5, on a Sawyer, on a Locobot, or even in simulation. So we have been trying to integrate it closely with simulation. Our goal is to develop this research ecosystem where PyRobot will host all the state-of-the-art models, all the implementations of state-of-the-art algorithms. So if you want to compare to the latest approach, you can compare. There are going to be tools. There are going to be data sets, and so on. And hopefully, this is where we can make robotics research easy for everyone, and everyone can come and do this. I found it very hard. I am a computer vision PhD student when I did my PhD. I wanted to do robotics because I realized that computer vision has a bottleneck until we solve robotics. But I found it very hard. It took, for 1 year, my robot was just lying with nothing happening around it. So that is why we want to cut out this bottleneck for everyone else, essentially. And so we want to reduce this entry barrier. Currently, it supports this cheap robot, Locobot, which you can buy online or you can assemble yourself. There is Sawyer, UR5, and AI Habitat is a simulation platform from Facebook that is closely integrated. We are also integrated like Gazebo and VREP and so on. And a lot of universities are already using it. So there are already like 4 I've listed, and 30 more universities, including UIUC and other universities, are going to be using it. So hopefully, we can create this momentum where all of us can contribute to common platforms and common research and make research faster in robotics, like it is in computer vision and NLP. I think we should do the same in robotics as well. With that, I want to thank all the students who have helped with this, and I'm ready to take questions.